Hello everyone, I'm Dr. J, professor from the Department of Periodontology. I'm here to give a voiceover for a PPT on lasers in periodontal management, hype or a hope. My presentation will cover on the myth and the facts about the functions of the diode laser in the field of dentistry. When it comes to the laser, there is a myth that it can replace the conventional procedure. There are a lot of questions that creeps both for the practitioner and the students, like laser is completely painless and the use of local anesthesia is not always indicated, and it can replace the conventional flap surgery in all conditions and cases, and sutures was not always indicated when you are using this laser, and the magical wand, I mean the laser, can replace the conventional bone grafting with regenerative capacity. And the funniest of all, the 7 watts laser will perform far better than the 3 watts laser just because there was an increase in the numerical value. To know all that, let's focus a little bit on the laser physics. As we all strongly believe, the nature has a tendency to heat. Even during this corona crisis, we strongly believe in increasing or boosting our immunity in a natural way. The sun god, which is an incredible composition of the nature, occupied a central position in the Egyptian, Greek, and Indian mythos. During the later periods of Roman history, sun worship gained in importance and ultimately led to what has been called solar monotheism, which is a forefather of atheism. Nearly all the gods of the period were possessed of solar qualities. The visible light which they worshipped is a small band of what is called electromagnetic spectrum. This electromagnetic spectrum is a range of frequency of electromagnetic radiation and the respective wavelength of the photon energy which is emitted. That includes FM to X-rays ranging below 1 Hz to 10 to the power of 25 Hz. The laser, here it belongs to the spectrum right near the infrared region. Okay, to know about the laser physics, you should know a little bit about this gentleman, Albert Einstein. The root of all this technological innovation lies in the fundamental physics research, specifically a 1917 paper by Albert Einstein on the quantum theory of radiation. Albert Einstein proposed that an atom, as you see in the picture A, after stimulation gets excited and it releases a photon, which is the energy package. And after releasing it, it will return to the lower energy state, and this process is called a spontaneous emission. And as you all know, a laser is an acronym for light amplification by stimulated emission of radiation. It describes that any device that creates and amplifies a narrow focused beam of light and whose photons are coherent. This picture shows the characteristics of the laser light which is emitted compared to the normal light waves, where the laser waves are monochromatic, collimated, that is parallel and non-diverging, and it is unidirectional, that is coherent rays compared to the natural rays. And in a laser, the atoms or molecules of the lasting medium, which is can be either crystal like ruby or garnet or a gas or a liquid, are pumped by a simple mechanism called this lasing mechanism. And here you can see the pumping source, which is the electronic current which is paused. And as I said, the lasing material which is inside in the form of a gas or a diode laser component, everything get excited, and there is a series of mirror which can reflect, that is instead of in addition to the simulation mechanism, there is a amplification mechanism is done by a series of mirror. By stimulated emission, finally a laser beam is derived, and the end result is a sudden burst of coherent light as the atom discharge in a rapid chain reaction. This process is finally called as a stimulated emission. The most important component of lasing mechanism is, we call it population inversion. That is nothing but the number of atoms that is in excited state than in the ground state. So that defines the stimulated emission, that is amplification mechanism, which we have seen in the diode laser. Coming to the evolution of a diode laser, to a small pen-type laser, we should know more about the nanoparticle that is evolved over a period of time. The diode laser uses a semiconductor device, and the most commonly used semiconductor device here is aluminium, gallium, arsenide. And this choice of semiconductor material determines the wavelength of the emitted beam. It is basically when a semiconductor device is placed between the highly polished reflecting surface, similar to the picture which we showed earlier for a pumping mechanism, the electric energy is passed to the semiconductor device, and this electric energy will convert to a light energy, and thus the diode laser can function. Here in this picture, you can see the different types of laser with different wavelength. The diode laser, which here falls near the infrared range between 800 to 1000 wavelength, and we have a diode laser of 810 nanometer wavelength to 980 nanometer wavelength of different brands of almost same function. And basically here you can see the carbon dioxide laser with 10,000 nanometer wavelength. And as you all know, like, the lasers with different wavelength have different function. That differs between a soft tissue laser with a hot tissue laser.
7 minutes.
You should know about the effect of laser on the irradiated tissue. Again, a little bit of laser physics. The basic interaction of laser radiation with the tissue is here in this picture. When a light strikes the tissue, a portion of the light is reflected. Some of the light may be transmitted through a tissue, and the remainder of the light is absorbed by the tissue. It has been experimentally observed that the elevation of temperature is proportional to the light output or the power of the laser. This is called the photothermal reaction. So out of this four action which you are seeing in interaction with the tissues, the absorption is the key phenomenon, and that is called the photothermal reaction. So what happens when tissue get heated? Once the laser beam interact with the tissue, there will be elevation of temperature, and when it is between the 37 to 50 degrees centigrade, there will be a hyperthermia, and when it is more than 60 degrees centigrade, there will be a protein denaturation, that is coagulation will take place, which will lead to the tissue welding, which occurs when a temperature reaches to 70 to 90 degrees. This tissue welding is an important fact for we are claiming the lasers, like, we don't need a suturing when you use a laser. So the tissue welding occurs at the 70 to 90 degrees centigrade, and when it reaches 100 to 150 degrees centigrade, there will be vaporization of tissue, and so when you are irradiating this laser on the edematous tissue, there will be a tissue shrinkage. And that's why, like, immediate post-op will be more effective when you're using laser, because of the vaporization of tissues takes place. And when you're using laser, you should be more careful not to overheat the tissue. That is, if you're overheating more than 200 degrees centigrade, there will be an unwanted reaction, that is carbonization will take place. Each of the diode laser wavelength is very well absorbed by the different chromophores involved in the tissue. And for the diode laser, the chromophores that is most commonly absorbed is the hemoglobin and melanin. So the target tissue is mainly a gingiva and mucosa. That's why the diode laser is mostly a soft tissue laser, and it has the least effect on the water, which is most commonly seen in the tooth surface. So the hot tissue laser, which is most commonly used, erbium yag, is most concentrated and more commonly absorbed by the water and hydroxyapatite crystals. And this erbium yag, you can see the wavelength is about 2940 nanometer wavelength. And the target tissue is basically, along with the gingiva and mucosa, more enamel, dentin, and bone is affected. So we are dealing with the diode laser, that is soft tissue laser and is least absorbed by the water and most commonly absorbed by the hemoglobin and melanin. That's why there is a less bleeding and deep pigmentation and aesthetic effect is achieved by advanced laser. So the coefficient, absorption coefficient of chromophores will determine the functions of the laser terminology should always remember is the joule and the watt. The joule is nothing but the unit of energy, that is ability of the laser to do the work. That is always dependent and directly proportional to the watt which we use. That is, watt is nothing but the unit of power, that is rate of doing the work. So to simplify, 1 watt in your diode laser setting, if you keep, that is 1 joule per second is the ability to do the work. Accordingly, you should keep your setting in your practice, because as you all know, like the resultant laser energy will heat the tissue, and overheating will that is more than 200 degrees centigrade will result in carbonization. So you should always very careful in the setting which we are using. Coming to the laser operation parameter, it can be either contact mode or non-contact mode. Contact mode is the tip which we use here, the optical fiber is in contact with the tissue, and the concentrated delivery of the laser energy will be seen, and the charring formation will be seen at the tip of a fiber optical tip. And tactile feedback is available. That is the most important factor when you're using in the contact mode. And basically for any excision procedure, cutting of the tissues or injecting procedure, we will be using mostly in the contact mode. And the non-contact mode mainly will be used in the case of LLT, or it can be used in the after ulcer condition or pain management. The tip is kept 0.5 to 1 millimeter away from the tissue, and laser energy delivered at the surface is always reduced compared to the contact mode. And the tactile feedback is not available here, and it is only by the visual contact. The clinical application in periodontics is initial non-surgical pocket therapy. It can be used, and excisional procedure like phenectomy and gingivectomy. And the de-epithelialization, that is aesthetic procedure, can be done because it is most commonly absorbed in the melanin pigment. And the removal of granulation tissue, the osseous recontouring and crown lengthening, and second surgery of implant, that is exposing the implant structure. And it can be used in the peri-implanted disc condition also. And the other excision procedure is opoclectomy we can use. After highlighting too much on the laser physics, we can straight away go to a case report where we have taken one clinical entity and compared between the laser and the conventional flap surgery. And the cases we have selected is of a gingival enlargement. And in that, the first entity will be a small area of enlargement where there is a horizontal bone loss and the abundance of keratinous tissues present. So in that case, we have used a gingivectomy, that is excision of gingival tissue with the laser. And the second entity where there is a large area of enlargement with the presence of angular osseous defect and very limited keratinous tissue. So the expense of excising the tissue is limited. So we used a periodontal flap. This picture can clearly tell them mindset of most of the practitioner by emphasizing laser as an holistic approach in the periodontal management. So let's see the reality fact. Here you can see a clear case of gingival enlargement, which is almost a grade 3 gingival enlargement, which involves both marginal and attached gingiva. And here you can clearly see the local factors, which is present. And the radiograph which is taken, you can see the upper anterior have a angular defect. So as we mentioned earlier, the luxury of doing a gingivectomy in this case with a limited keratinized tissue and angular defect is very less. So we plan for a conventional flap surgery in upper anterior. And you can see in the lower anterior with a horizontal defect. So we used lasers in this case for excising the tissue. So this is after a simple scaling and root. You can see here the difference between the preoperative and after scaling and root planing. As we all say that scaling and by removing the local factor, most of the inflammatory component will be reduced and the amount of tissue to deal with in the surgical phase is always minimum. So the main emphasis should be given to a scaling and root planing, and the reevaluation should be done a minimum after a month to check the tissue response to the local factor. And as I said, the lower anterior, the diode laser is used, and the setting was about 1 watts. As we all say that watts is 1 joule per second. And the duration, that is the strokes which we are giving in the lower anterior, it is also always a vertical strokes, and sufficient cooling of tissue by means of saline irrigation should be done, because as I said, the photothermal reaction to the irradiated tissue should be at the minimum level so that the overheating of the tissue will be avoided, and it is in the contact mode with the activated fiber optic tip. Here you can see the 1 day post-operative picture, and the inflammatory component is very much reduced, and the patient comfort in the form of pain is almost totally nil. So the healing component and the patient comfort, everything was satisfactory in the lower anterior, and the flap elevation, that is conventional surgery, was done in the upper anterior, and the envelope flap is elevated. You can see the angular defect over there, and mild osteotomy procedure was carried out, and the suturing was done. Here you can see the 1 week post-operative picture. When you see with the pre-operative picture, that healing is very much satisfactory, even in the conventional flap surgery. So according to me, there is no holistic approach with laser. The conventional flap surgery is very much indicated, and it can be used with precision. So the results here, we used a Vaughan Bancroft pain rating scale, and in the form of a smileys, because nowadays we use smileys in our social media. So it is from the smiley to no hurt to the worst. So everything is taken right from the initial incision to the finishing of the procedure. This is the comparative evaluation between the conventional flap surgery with the laser, with the parameters like local anesthesia. The amount of local anesthesia needed in a conventional flap surgery is always more compared to the laser. And the weight of the gauze we measured pre-operative with after the procedure. And then we found that amount of bleeding is more in scalpel compared to the laser. And the duration of the incision, that is the procedure, is more in scalpel and laser. And the pain in the first post-operative and third post-operative day is very much less in laser compared to the scalpel. So the patient comfort zone was found to be well under control in laser compared to the conventional flap surgery. Coming to the good and the bad about the laser. The good thing is all the excision procedure was carried out with ease, and the suturing was almost not needed in most of the cases, like gingivectomy or gingivoplasty, phrenectomy, gingival sculpting or troughing, everything. There is no need for suturing, and the patient comfort zone was at the maximum level. And the myth which we found out in this study was the zero anesthesia concept was always not there. Some amount of anesthesia was needed, and the new attachment was not always possible with the laser. So the replacement for regenerative periodontal therapy was not always the case. So the conventional flap with the bone graft and guided tissue regeneration was always indicated if there is angular type of bone loss. If there is a horizontal bone loss with the least amount of keratinous tissues affected, then you can go for a laser. So the final conclusion of my presentation is, laser is not always a magical pill against periodontitis. We need the laser as an adjunct to the conventional flap surgery to aid in a better periodontal management. Finally, be in shape periodontally as well. Thank you.